أنت الحبيب المصطفى، أنت الأمين، يا خير خلق الله خير المرسلين.
إنما يخشى الله من عباده العلماء.
الحمد لله، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، we are at the time in the hijrah of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, in the seerah of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. So there is the seerah, which is general, and then there is the hijrah. And after the hijrah of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم begins the Islamic calendar. So we are in the second year after Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam made the hijrah, in the beginning of the month of Ramadan. And now, as we mentioned before, there were eight scrimmages where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would send battalions out, or somebody would try to attack Medina, and they would have small exchanges, or many times there wouldn't even be any fighting. In the same method, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was informed about a caravan. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not planning for a battle. When we talk about Badr, it was not planned as a battle. It was planned only as a way to put some pressure on the people of Mecca, not to rob and steal the wealth of the Muslims. And we'll discuss this in a little depth in a few minutes, but before we begin, I want to point out a couple of very important things. Some things we don't understand about the importance of Badr. Why is Badr so important? And how do we know that it is important? The first thing, as Muslims, we consider Badr important because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned the Quran many times. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, the great Sahabi, Ibn Abbas, the great Mufassir, once he was asked about Surah Anfal. Surah Anfal that we find in the Quran. He said this is Surah Al-Badr. Yani, he was giving an explanation that Surah Anfal could even be called Surah Badr just because of the fact that there was so many references to the Battle of Badr in Surah Anfal. We also find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentioned the Battle of Badr in Surah Ali Imran, in Surah Anfal, in Surah Hajj, in Surah Dukhan, and many other places. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Ali Imran, he tells Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba radiallahu anhum and us today, وَلَقَدْ نَصَرَكُمْ اللَّهُ بِبَدْرٍ, that verily, لَقَدْ, and he with emphasis, نَصَرَكُمْ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you nusra on the day of Badr, يعني ببدر. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَأَنْتُمْ أَذَلَّا, يعني you were disgraced, you were weak. Don't think that Badr was a victory because you were strong in number. And this is very important for us to understand. When we talk about Badr, or we talk about Uhud, or Hunayn, or any of these battles, remember one thing, there's a principle, that our responsibility is to prepare to the best of our ability. But the Nusra is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yani the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is to destroy the mighty upon the hands of the weak. What is the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? To destroy the mighty upon the hands of the weak. If we look at Fir'aun, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't give Musa alayhi salam weaponry and didn't tell Bani Israel to just take up a lot of weapons. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed Fir'aun with water. Not something that we control and ride on and sail on and all those kinds of things. When we look at throughout the Quran, throughout the Ahadith, when you take Namrud or Tarun or anybody who was destroyed, you will find that this is the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's very important to keep in mind about Badr. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew what was going to happen. And as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had done at many other times, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have revealed wahi, could have revealed some revelation to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that you are not just going against 40 people in a caravan. There's going to be over 1,000 people from Mecca that you're going to face. So equip up, and you could have told all the Sahaba in Medina to go out. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't. He let them go out as very few and ill-equipped to show that the Nusra is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And here in Surah Al-Imran, in the 123rd ayah that I recited, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here, then he points to this, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that supported you bi badrin, yani in Badr. And you were weak, you were disgraced, Allah strengthened you. And then he says, فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ. So have taqwa of Allah, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. If only you were thankful. SubhanAllah. Beautiful advice tied to victory. How will you get the victory? Only with the nusra of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Today, even the Islamic movements, they don't say this anymore. They say only if you have a strong lobby, only if you have nuclear energy, and if you have this, and if we have this kind of an army, and if we have this. They don't say that if we are upon the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we have taqwa, if we are thankful to Allah, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give us victory. No, today we become just another shade of every other type of movement. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clarifies this in the Quran for us. When we talk about the importance of Badr, the fact that it is repeated in the Quran in many ayats, many times. I even mentioned some of the surah of the Quran where it's mentioned. Many of the ulama say it's mentioned many other ayat, and then there is khilaf on some of them. But it's continuously mentioned in the Quran. So this tells us it's important. But even if we look at non-Muslim historians, and we have what they call Orientalists. What does that mean, Orientalists? The Western world used to think it is them, and then everybody else is strange. They're Oriental, they're whatever. Like they would call Asians from Eastern Asia Orientals. Racist terms that were used. They would always want to make everything wanted to be Eurocentric. When you talk about East, East of what? East of Europe. You talk about Middle East, Middle to the East of what? Middle to the East of Europe. So everything had to be Eurocentric. So they made these authors, they paid them to go study other cultures. And one of them, they studied one of the groups of these Orientalists, they studied Islam. But not with the sense of finding the truth or trying to have an academic discussion, but more to try to destroy Islam. More to try to speak ill about Islam, to study Islam, to try to misuse that knowledge to take advantage of the Arab or Muslims in general. But even these Orientalists, if you read through some of their writings, they wrote that the Battle of Badr was one of the most decisive and important battles in the history of mankind. Not just in the history of Islam. Non-Muslims, they said in the history of all of mankind. Why? They said, because if, and according to them, the Orientalists, we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wrote the Qadr. But they say that if the Quraysh, the Mushrikeen, were able to get the upper hand in Badr and kill the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't write that, but this is what they write. They said it would have stopped Islam altogether. Islam would have finished. And the face of the world would be very different. The 1.56 billion Muslims would not be there. So they said that Badr was one of the most decisive and important battles in the history of the entire mankind. And we know that our importance of Badr is tied to the Quran and to the authentic ahadith. We know that Jibreel alayhi salam, I'm just giving you some very important points to first understand. He told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam that the best of the malaika, who are the best of the angels? The best of the angels are the Badri angels. Yani those angels that came in Badr, they are considered the highest rank amongst angels. As the best of Sahaba are the Badri Sahaba. Those Sahaba that were in Badr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive them even if they make sins in the future. Because they're high rank and importance of Badr. Now, when we talk about Badr, one of the, criticisms that some of the Rafida or the filth of the earth, they bring forward, is they say, well, Uthman bin Affan radiallahu anhu was not present in Badr. And in Sahih Bukhari and other books of Ahadith, we see a response to this even from Abdullah bin Umar radiallahu anhu. When he said, that Uthman bin Affan radiallahu was ready for Badr. And Badr was not a fard al-ain jihad. And this was not meant to be like where every Sahabi had to go. Badr was only supposed to stop a caravan. So it was only voluntary. Where I wanted to go, would go. But Uthman bin Affan radiallahu would always be ready. Always. If you look at what he did in Tabuk and how he equipped the army, you will see that he was a great companion of the Prophet ﷺ. So Uthman radiallahu anhu, he came ready to go with Rasulullah ﷺ. But his wife, who was a daughter of Rasulullah ﷺ, was gravely ill. She was very ill. So the Prophet ﷺ told Uthman bin Affan radiallahu anhu that this is not where everybody has to go. So you, according to my command, according to the order of Rasulullah ﷺ, you should stay back and take care of your wife. She's very sick, she's very ill. And, subhanAllah, it's very important. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that your niyyah is such that you will have a full reward in the spoils of war. If we win, whatever we get, you will have a full reward like somebody who is there, and you will have a full reward in ajr, in the reward. So here, this is why Uthman bin Affan radiallahu anhu is considered a Badri Sahabi, even though he wasn't present in Badr. Because he had the niyyah and he was obeying the Amir. It's very important for us today. Today we forget the importance of obeying an Amir, of being together. You know, somebody wants to go do something, even if it's a good thing, you don't just go up and do it. It is important to be united. It is important to be together. It is important for us to understand that sometimes you may have the best of intentions, but if the Amir tells you, step down, stand down, hold your horses, obey the Amir. In obedience to the Amir, there is the khayr in it. And that's why Uthman bin Affan radiallahu anhu obeyed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who is the Amir, and he is a Badri Sahaba. Now, a couple of other important things about Badr. How did caravans come and go? In the time of the Arab, what would happen in Jahiliyyah, that a man would take his goods and he would go and trade. Or maybe he had a partner, like he would be trading for somebody else, like Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to do for Khadija radiallahu anha. But in Badr, the caravan that Abu Sufyan had was not his personal caravan. It was not his personal caravan. Rather, it was the caravan carrying all of the wealth of the different leaders of Mecca and the wealth of the Muslims. It was very important, historical fact, that the wealth of the Muslim that had been taken from Mecca, stolen by the Mushrikeen, the haqq of the Muslims was taken to Sham. And this was on its way back. When it was going, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he had Ghazwatul Ushayra. Ghazwatul Ushayra was when Rasulullah was trying to stop the same caravan going to Sham. Now the same caravan is coming back after having sold the goods of the Muslims and the wealth of the people of Mecca. And in that caravan, according to Ibn Ishaq and many of the historians, and Al-Mubarakuri and Ibn Al-Qayyim al-Jawziyah and others, there was 50,000 dinar of gold. Yani gold dinar. 50,000 dinar was a huge amount. And a part of this is the wealth of the Muslims that was stolen from them. A gold dinar is not like the Kuwaiti dinar today, or a dirham, or a dollar. It's pure gold. And understanding that this is something very valuable, to have 50,000 of them and to know that from it is the wealth of the Muslims coming back from Sham, coming back from Syria with only 40 men. So here Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sent two people to investigate. This is before Badr. Now this is the whole story about Badr. So now the caravan is coming back from Syria, from Sham, and Sham and Mecca have in middle of them Medina. Yani you have to cross the outskirts of Medina, not necessarily the city, to go from Sham to Mecca. So it's close to Medina. And here Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sent two men to investigate. And we should learn the sunnah, how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to deal in battle, the war. Who did he send? He sent Talha ibn Ubaidullah, Talha ibn Ubaidullah, and Sa'id bin Zayd. Both of them great Sahaba, both of them have been given glad tidings of Jannah. But Talha ibn Ubaidullah and Sa'id bin Zayd were sent to investigate. And they first went and found out about what's going on. This is important. It's not just about just take a gun and start shooting. No, no, no. That's not the way battles work. That's not the way Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did things. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used the best of strategies, because again, upon us is to do the best we can. And then, tawakkaltu ala Allah. And then we put our tawakkal on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here, Talha and Sa'id, and you know Sa'id bin Zayd? You know Sa'id bin Zayd is? He is the brother-in-law of Umar bin Khattab radiyallahu anhu. He is the one that was living with his sister when Umar radiyallahu anhu came after them. He's one of the 10. Next time we ask who are the 10 giving the that time in the Jannah, everybody forgets Sa'id bin Zayd. He's one of those 10. So they found out that the caravan's coming, they found out the route, and they found out that there were 40 men. But Abu Sufyan, he was also a very intelligent man. Radiallahu anhu, later on he becomes a Muslim, a Sahabi. At this time, he's a Mushrik. But he's very intelligent. And look at this hadith. And I checked the authenticity, so authentic narration. He scouted out the area around. And he went to some of the Bedouins, and he went to certain people, and he asked them, what do you know about what's going on? So he was also aware that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam or the Sahaba then could come. So he was very careful about his movements. He didn't come directly to Mecca. He made a zigzag path. And then later on, we'll discuss inshallah a couple of other things he did, but understand that he was also using excellent strategy. Then when the Quraysh were heedless of this issue, Abu Sufyan, he figured out that there is danger. So he started to move a different way. When Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam heard about this caravan coming with nothing more than 40 men, he took the Sahaba with him, and as we mentioned, some of the narrations mentioned 300, some 313, some 317, but between 300 to 317 of the Sahaba. And he went out, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself, and he also didn't go directly to Badr or to confront. He also made a plan. SubhanAllah, he went towards one side and then the other and then investigated. But while he was coming, Abu Sufyan asked one of the Bedouins, do you know of anybody like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam coming towards me? So the Bedouin said, we don't know, but we did see some people take water who we didn't recognize to be from here and go towards this other side. So Abu Sufyan goes to that location. Now, this is a Sahih hadith, and pay attention. What did he do? He found the droppings or the dung or the poop of the camels. And he took a stick and he split the poop. Now this may sound like ridiculous, right? But when he split it, he found date seeds. He found what? The stone that's inside the date seed, called a date stone. He found it in the droppings of the camels. And Abu Sufyan, subhanAllah, he was so intelligent, he said, I know that nobody feeds their camels dates except for the people of Medina. Ajib. You know, we don't know a lot about Badr. We think we know. We think it was just like, you know, you went and they saw and three people, one of them being some actor, Anthony Quinn, you know, we see these stupid Hollywood recreations, and we don't know the real history. We don't know what is Sahih. So here Abu Sufyan, he figured out that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the people of Medina are close. So he sent a man from Banu Ghifar. And this man, it's a very interesting story about this man. This man, he was known as Zamzam. Zamzam from Banu Ghifar. And he was sent by Abu Sufyan to warn the people of Mecca. But he was a rough man. He was hired and he had his own way. Zamzam ibn Amr al-Ghifari, he took a horse, a very fast horse, and he got to Mecca right away, as fast as he could. And what did he do? The first thing, and there is some khilaf between the ulama of Tariq, but I'll give you a general idea. Some of the ulama said he broke his own nose. He broke his own nose. I mean, he's pretty dedicated, you know, because he wanted to show a show of importance. So he broke his own nose and took off his clothes, all of them, and turned his saddle upside down, and went in front of the Kaaba, and jumped off his camel, didn't get off, jumped off, fell on the ground, put dirt on himself, and started telling the people of Mecca, "You're destroyed, you're destroyed, you're destroyed, your merchandise has been attacked." Some of the other ulama, they said that he went and he jumped off the camel, ripped his clothes. They seem to agree about that part. I mean, the people before Islam, they didn't care about the awrah. They didn't care about their awrah. And this is why Islam brought izzah and dignity. So when he ripped off his clothes, in these narrations, he cut off the nose of his camel and the ears of the camel. The poor camel, the dhulm. Yeah. He cut off the ears and nose of the camel, let it bleed to make a point to the people of Mecca. And he started telling the people of Mecca that, "Look, your merchandise is going to be destroyed, gather your army." So here, the people of Mecca, as we mentioned earlier, they gathered, all of them except a few people. So the people of Mecca, they were people of Ghira as well, they had honor. So they got together and all of them put their fighters forward except the Banu Adi. Banu Adi, they didn't participate. They stepped back. Why? Many of the ulama have different reasons, but we do know that they didn't. Another person who didn't participate is Abu Lahab. Abu Lahab, the enemy of Islam, the enemy of Allah, the cursed one in the Quran, we know that he was very intelligent. And from Tariq, we know he was very handsome. And he was known for his good looks and his intelligence, and he was very rich. But he was a coward. He was not brave. So he didn't want to fight. Instead, somebody who owed him a debt, he told him that we'll consider the debt paid, you go. And he thought, Abu Lahab, that he could avoid debt by doing this. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought a curse upon him, and a disease began from his hands, and he died in Mecca during the days of Badr. Yani that's when the days that the disease began upon him. And even though he didn't go for Badr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought death to him. Now, one more important Quraishi who wanted to say that is Umayyah bin Khalaf. And there's a very important hadith as well. Umayyah bin Khalaf, he knew, and we discussed this in the earlier durus, from Sa'ad the Ansari radiallahu anhu, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had said that I will be the one who kills Ubayy. Yani Umayyah bin Khalaf will die upon my hands. And even though Umayyah bin Khalaf is a staunch enemy of Islam, a kafir, a mushrik, somebody who hates the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but he had full yaqeen in the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanallah, today we as Muslims, we don't have that yaqeen in the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Somebody tells you a fadila, a fada'il, a virtue about a certain act that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "You will get this or you will get that." We're like, okay. But Umayyah bin Khalaf, he is a kafir, but he knew it, that if Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said it, it will happen. So he said, "I'm not going. Because I know if I go, I'm going to die." So what did Abu Jahl do? Abu Jahl, he was an enemy, he was a very, very wicked man. He got somebody to get a ring. And he put bukhur, you know the smelling, you know the bukhur you light. And nowadays we put bukhur in the masjid and the houses. But in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this was usually done by women. Because the bukhur, it brings a nice smell. And the women would be the ones that took care of the house. So they would light the bukhur in the house. And they would put the smell on themselves for their husband to enjoy, and then they would put it on the house. They wouldn't put it when they were going outside, put the perfume thing outside, no, but in the house. Today, alhamdulillah, with women at home, they don't care how they look, they don't care how they smell when they're going out. MashaAllah, they spend 2 hours getting ready with makeup and spray paint and all kinds of chemical products that are known to cause. So, but the opposite was true about the Sahabiyat, and also in the Arab tradition. So in the Arab tradition, the woman would put the bukhur. So he told this other man to bring the bukhur to him, to Umayyah bin Khalaf. So he's sitting in the Kaaba. Umayyah bin Khalaf comes in. He tells Umayyah, "Here is some bukhur for you." Umayyah looks at him strange, like, "Why?" He says, "Because you're a woman, so you might as well put some bukhur on."
أبو جهل هذا wicked man. So he tells the women, "Khalaf, you're a woman, so put some kafura. So when we go and fight and you stay home, at least you can feel nice for us when we come home." So Umayyah ibn Khalaf, he gets upset, and obviously he has Ghira as well. He decides, "In that case, I'm going home, getting my sword, let's go. Let's do it! Let's do this!" So Umayyah ibn Khalaf goes home, he tells his wife, "Bring my armor, bring my sword." His wife tells him, "Don't you forget what that Ansari, and what that man from Yathrib, they used to call Yathrib, had said." He said, "I remember, but what should I do? Because this is what he did to me, and you know, no matter what, I'm a man, so I'm going." So Umayyah ibn Khalaf, he starts to go. But then he tells his wife something interesting. He tells his wife, "Like, I don't want to be dishonored, so I'm going to go. Well, on the way, I'm going to leave them and come back." So he sets out with Abu Jahl. And on the way, he tells Abu Jahl, "I have some very important work. I'll be right back." So Abu Jahl tells him, "You are from the leaders of Quraysh. If you go back, the other Awam, the regular people, will follow you and go back. So you gotta stay." And he convinced him to stay until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fulfilled the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And inshaAllah you will hear in these durus how he died at the hand of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So other than this, mostly only women and a few people stayed back. 1,300 men from Mecca with 100 horses and 600 of them armored. Professional soldiers. It's very important. Because what does it mean? Their armor was such that swords couldn't harm them. You know, Zubair ibn Awam, it's not here, we'll say this in the seerah. Later on, when he fights one kafir, he's armored up, only thing he's showing is his eyes, like a little slit. Zubair ibn Awam is only wearing a izab. He's not even wearing a shirt. It's battle. He drops the kafir, he puts his spear on top, and he kicks it, and he punches it, and he pushes it through, crushes it. Nothing can stop that. But this is the means. Today, imagine tanks and planes and drones. This was the weapons of that time. The Muslims had two horses. The Muslims had no fully armored trained soldiers. Not a single one. And the Mushrikeen here, with 1,300 men, 100 horses, 600 armored men with professional soldiers coming out against the Muslims. Now, the Quraysh, they had a problem with a tribe called Banu Bakr. Banu Bakr was a qabila of the Arab. And they had a problem with the Quraysh. So the Quraysh was worried that if we start heading out towards Medina, Banu Bakr is behind us. Banu Bakr's location will be to the rear of us. And if they see this opportunity, if they attack us from the back, we're going to be destroyed. So the Quraysh, many of them started saying, "You know what, let's just get Abu Sufyan to try to maneuver his way out and let's not go." But Shaytan, Iblis, very important. Iblis, he came in the form of a man named Suraqa bin Malik from Banu Kanan. He's from the tribe of Banu Kanan. And he told him that, "Don't worry. We guarantee you, Banu Kanan guarantees you protection from the rear." Now, subhanAllah, this was not Suraqa bin Malik. Suraqa bin Malik was a real man. Later on, he admitted and people proved that he never went to the Quraysh. So what does that tell us? As a Sahih narration, one thing it tells us that Shaytan can come in the shape of a person. Iblis himself. Secondly, it tells us that how excited Shaytan was for the Muslims to be defeated. That Iblis was actively working to try to get the Quraysh to finish off the Muslims. Thirdly, it tells us that Iblis doesn't know the future. Nobody knows the future except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are some things about the future that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals to the Anbiya, but nobody knows everything except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Iblis knew what's going to happen in Badr, he would have told the Quraysh stay home. Some people give jinn and Iblis too much credit. Jinn are a creation of Allah. Iblis is a creation of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is father of all of them. So here Iblis, he comes and he does this trick with the Quraysh and he makes it so that they go. Abu Sufyan, he knows about Quraysh coming, but he realizes that he can maneuver away from the Muslims and he can win a battle. And Abu Sufyan, he has the thing in his heart. And that's why later Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides him. that he's not so evil like Abu Jahl. He's not so intent on just trying to destroy the Muslims. He hasn't been guided yet, but he has this thing. So he sends a message to the Quraysh that go back, I'm gonna maneuver out, you don't need to come. But when the message reaches Abu Jahl, Abu Jahl, he is a man of kibr, staunch pride. Abu Jahl says, I came out and we're not going back until na'udhu billah, يعني from his words, will finish Muslims and have the help of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Abu Jahl, with his pride, he insists and he continues. Now one of the tribes, one of the sub-tribes of Quraysh, Banu Zahra. Banu Zahra, they were there and they had a man, Al-Akhnas. Al-Akhnas gave them the nasiha that you guys don't destroy yourself with Abu Jahl. يعني Abu Hikam, as they called him at the time. You should go back. Even if the rest are not going back, swallow your pride, go back, because this is not an intelligent move. Banu Zahra, they listened to Al-Akhnas and they went back. And that's why 300 people went back and the final army was 1,000 people. Interestingly, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, he says that later on, Banu Zahra, when they after Badr, they made Al-Akhnas as if he was their chief. يعني everything he said, they listened to him afterwards because they saw his wisdom in them not going with the Quraysh towards Badr. So now from 1300, the Quraysh ended up with 1,000 now. They still have 100 horses, they still have 600 armed men, but they have become less from the original number. Now Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was not planning for battle. Like I said, this was one of those times where only a few people were supposed to go and put a fear on the Quraysh that, look, stop stealing our wealth and stop selling it and taking it. It was just supposed to be one of those types of battles. When the news came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had his own network of spies, this is the whole subject we could get into, was the intelligence gathering of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When the news came back, he realized that now these few Sahaba, 300 about, with only two horses. Many of the Sahaba didn't have swords. They didn't, some of the people said they went with leaves and sticks, and this is stupidity. What are you going to do with the leaves? Come on. This is not sahih. But what we do find is that not everybody had a sword. Some people only had spears, some people had swords, some people had less weaponry. They were not heavily equipped, but they came with whatever they could. So now he realizes that they're not equipped. They don't have enough camels, they don't have enough horses, they don't have enough people. But the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he himself has a very high level of tawakkul. But he showed us a way. What did he do? He made shura with the Sahaba. And he asked the Sahaba, what should we do? And this is the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is our way of decision making as Muslims, the shura. Now who is the face and who is the one who makes the decision? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And now he asked the Sahaba, what do you think we should do? Do you know, subhanAllah, who is the first one to speak? Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu, who's always first in everything. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu is the first one. He says, Ya Rasulullah, you are the Messenger of Allah. Make the decision. We are with you in any condition. Let's go. Sometimes, you know, when we read or listen to some of the khutbahs, they make Abu Bakr radiallahu seem very weak. He was a soft-hearted man. He would cry a lot in the salah, but he was a strong man. A man of great willpower. Umar radiallahu was physically stronger, but in willpower you will see that Abu Bakr radiallahu was stronger. Abu Bakr radiallahu was the first one to speak. Who spoke next? The second man to speak? Umar bin Khattab radiallahu. When we talk about who became Khalifa when, there are so many ayat and ahadith and dalail that this is the way it should be. Umar ibn Khattab is the second man to speak. The third one to speak to Uthman is not there. Is Miqdad. Al-Miqdad radiallahu anhu. And he says to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that we will not say to you, like the Yahud said to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, idhab anta wa rabbuka. Faqatila. Yani idhab anta wa rabbuka. Al-Mutanna. Faqatila. Wa inna hahuna qa'idun. Yani Banu Israel, they told Musa alayhi salam that you and your Rabb, you go, you fight, and we will stay here and we will be safe. This is what Bani Israel used to say. You go ahead, we're going to stay back. He says, no, we will say, idhab anta wa rabbuka faqatila wa inna ma'akuma. Yani nahnu ma'akuma muqatilun. He says that we will say to you, O Rasulullah, that go, you and your Rabb, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we are with you fighting for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the way of the mu'min. Not to just tell somebody else, hey, you go do that. This is fiqh we should be taking here. You know what we get a lot? We get a lot of people that are telling you what you're doing wrong. Brother, you did this wrong. Your khutbah, you said this wrong. Brother, you did this wrong. In your talk, you did this wrong. The camera was like this. The sound was like this. And this was like this. And this was like that. Brother, you need to do this. We say, brother, step up. Come up. Help. Do something. You know, participate yourself. MashaAllah, you see some brothers, they're sadiqun in everything. In everything good, they're in the front. But then you see the vast majority of this ummah today, they just sit at home watching CNN or Fox or one of these news channels and talking about how Saudi is doing this wrong and Pakistan is this and Afghanistan is this and these Muslims are like this and this. And what are you doing yourself? Nothing. Not even making your salah on time. You're sitting there eating haram, whatever, just complaining and looking at faults of others. Some people, they have no durus, but they want to pick faults at any durs going on. Step up and teach a durs then. You know, you're just going to sit back and complain. This is not the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam or the Salaf al-Salihin, the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. Now those that spoke so far were all from the Mahajirun, like the people who made Hijrah. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he continued to ask. The Ansar realized that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is pointing towards them. So Sa'd bin Mu'ad radiallahu anhu, he steps up and he says, O Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I think you are asking for us. And he gave a very long talk, a very beautiful speech. The essence that I will quote to you from it is that we are ready to follow you wherever you go, in whatever conditions you go, whatever location you tell us to do. We are ready to fight till death, every single one of us. The Ansar were very brave people. You will see the Ansar are at the forefront of fighting, forefront of jihad throughout Islamic history. Very brave people. Even Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu, when he was there with Ubayd al-Jarrah and they were fighting the Romans and they were vastly outnumbered. Even at that time, he put the Ansar forward. And he said, why? He says, because I saw Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam doing the same and I saw the qualities of the Ansar. So the Ansar, they took this very bold step and they said, we are ready. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam then, he moved forward. Now we mentioned who was left in charge of Medina. It's some important things that happened. Ibn Maktum radiallahu anhu, the blind Sahabi, the Sahabi regarding which Surah Abasa has the first ayat revealed about. That great Sahabi, he was a very old man, he was blind, he was very weak, he was very poor. But he was such an important Sahabi that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed ayat to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, rebuking the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanallah, there was one kafir. He became Muslim. I was talking to him years and years and years ago. And I asked him, how did you become Muslim? He said, I was studying the Quran. He said, one thing that amazed me about the Quran, how he became Muslim. He said, one of the things about the Quran, he said, when I read Surah Abasa, when I read this surah, I saw that it was rebuking, it was speaking harshly to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So I knew that he couldn't have written it himself. You know, if you write something yourself, you're never going to talk harsh to yourself or speak bad about yourself. You're going to just glow and praise yourself. So he said, I realized that this was not from him, this was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I became Muslim through that. This Sahabi, because of these ayat, the Prophet ﷺ would always give him a lot of precedence. He would treat him very kindly. And people would ask him, he said that Allah has ordained me to focus on him. Look how the Prophet ﷺ accepted the warning. So he left him in charge of Medina. And he was a blind man and he would leave Salah. Some of the fuqaha in their books, they said, oh, it's makruh for a blind person to leave Salah. And this is without the need. It's another one of those things. Oh, a blind person may not know about their tahara. Why not? Tahara is because when people are careful, many people have eyesight, they're not careful about Tahara. But we know from the Sunnah that if the Prophet assigned a blind man to lead Salah, this is not makruh. It cannot be considered makruh. Because why would Prophet put something that has karaha? All these fuqaha, they come up with their own little things, they don't look at the Sahih Sunnah. So here Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left him. But at this time, there was a Sahabi with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Lubaba. Abu Lubaba radiallahu anhu. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, go back to Medina and leave Medina. Now why? There is a lot of hikam, a lot of wisdom, a lot of benefits behind this. And many of the ulama have gone into depth. Then none of them are clear from the wording of any hadith. But we can say one of the things is, that now Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam realizes that this is going to be a long extended battle. And now at this time, there may be an attack on Medina. And if a man is blind and is unable to understand where soldiers are coming, it will be difficult for him to defend Medina. Originally, was that supposed to be a very long expedition and those things? So he was a pious man, a good man who left it in charge. And this tells you that even if you make somebody amir or responsible, it is permissible to switch him out. And if somebody is switched out, they shouldn't get upset. Because everybody is doing this for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sent Abu Lubaba to Medina and he went forward. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he wanted news about the enemy. Because here, like we think everybody had GPSs. Like, okay, where are we going to meet at? Brother, all right, can you send me the address? I'll Google it. There it is. All right, put it in a GPS. It wasn't like that. You were in the middle of deserts. So armies many times wouldn't even be able to find each other. That's why many of the 8 earlier battles weren't battles, because they missed each other. So now here you have to get intelligence. You have to get information. You have to find out where the enemy is. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he wants to send somebody. What does he do? He himself goes. And this shows the tawadu of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The humbleness. So he himself goes, and who does he take with him? His sahib, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu, they go out and they find an old Bedouin. And they start to talk to him nicely. And he opens up to them. And he tells them. And they find out. And some of the other sahaba that were sent out, they heard 2 young women. One was telling the other that I know I owe you money. I know I owe you money, but there's a caravan that's coming with a lot of wealth, and we're gonna cook things and make things to sell to them, and they're coming from this location, so once we make some profit of selling stuff to them, then I'll pay you back. So they also realized which way the caravan of Abu Sufyan is coming. So they took this information back to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself and Abu Bakr radiyallahu anhu, with the information they gathered, they found out where the caravan is going to be. Now, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sent 3 of the Ansar and 3 of the Muhajireen to go and find out more information. Now here, Abu Sufyan has actually gone away, and now the army of Quraysh is sitting. So now they realize that caravan may have gone, but there's an army that is sitting. And the Prophet ﷺ had the option to run away, but he didn't. After the Shura, he decided to meet them in battle. So now he wants to find out more about where this army is. So he sent Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, Zubair ibn al-Awwam, and Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhum. 3 of them, all 3 of them for the people of Jannah again. These 3 were sent with 3 of the Ansar, and they found 2 young men that had been hired by the Quraysh. They were not from the army, but they were hired to bring water and things for them. So when they grabbed them, they asked them about the location. Those 3 men basically said, we're going to tell you everything. And they said everything that they knew. But some of the Ansar that were there, they were not satisfied. They thought maybe they knew more. So they started to physically abuse them, beat them. And here, when they were being beaten, they started to lie. Whatever they thought that they wanted to hear, they started to tell them whatever they thought. So here, when they told them a lot of false information, they not knowing it was false, they let them go. And this is a very important principle. Why torture doesn't work. Torture, it doesn't work. Because when you torture somebody, they'll tell you whatever you want to hear. If you torture somebody enough, you put them in enough pain, they'll tell you, I'm Superman, and the moon is made out of cheese, whatever, just stop torturing me. And that's why Islam is against torture. Because torture doesn't work. It's just inhumane. So when these men were brought to Rasulullah, the Prophet became upset with the Sahaba. And he told those Ansari Sahaba that you beat a man for telling the truth and you let him go for lying. Like when he was telling the truth, you beat him further. And when he lied, you let him go. And Rasulullah, he forbid torture. Instead, he sat them down, he made ikram for them, he was nice to them, and they told the Prophet everything honestly. And this is a hukam for us to understand in how to deal in these situations. And the Prophet ﷺ, he didn't say, beat them and tie them upside down and do this to them. No. Instead, he told them, speak to them nicely, they will tell you everything. And they did. Here, Rasulullah ﷺ, after getting this information, he prepared. And that night, and this is in Ramadan, it rained. And subhanAllah, as even a non-Muslim orientalist, he writes, don't want to mention his name because I'm not trying to promote them, they have a lot of falsehood. But even a non-Muslim, he writes, he said the rain was a blessing for the Muslims and a hardship for the Quraysh. Why? Because the position of the Quraysh became flooded and muddy. And the place of the Muslims was such that it gave them more water and benefit. So you see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing them that the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with them. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he prepared that night. And what was the method of preparation? The method of preparation is dua and salah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he made dua in the night. He stood in salah and he told the sahaba to stand. He didn't tell them, you're going to need your strength in the morning, get some rest, do some push-ups, get ready. No. He was preparing them spiritually. He made them ready. And the next morning, when they went out, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to one of the springs by the wells to take his place. One of the Sahaba, Al-Hubab radiallahu anhu, he told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that is this location that you're at wahi from Allah? Like, is this something from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or a strategy of war? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, this is only strategy. I don't have any wahi to be here. Then he says, then my opinion, O Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is we go back and we take one of the wells of Badr. There's an area called Badr. And we fill up all the other wells. All these creeks, all these springs will dry up. The source of the water, we take it and we close up all the other wells. So then they will be without water and we will have water. And if they want water, they will have to come to us and we will be able to attack them. And subhanAllah, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to his humblest, he didn't say, what? Me? I'm the messenger of Allah. I'm this, I'm that. Are you going to tell me? No. He took the opinion of Al-Hubab radiallahu anhu and they retreated from the original places. Now, the battle is about to begin. The armies are set. And the night, the Friday night, yani is what we would call Thursday night, but it's the night of Friday, on the 17th of Ramadan came. And here Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he spent the night in ibadah. Now around the same time, not on this night, but around the same time, in Mecca, there was something else that had happened. What had happened was Atiqah radiallahu anha, who is the aunt of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, later on she becomes a Muslimah. She is the sister of Hamza. Hamza and Abbas radiallahu anhu. Now Abbas radiallahu anhu was at this time in Mecca with the Quraysh. So Atiqah, she saw a dream. And basically in that dream, and there are some different versions of it, she saw that a punishment, a hardship is going to come on the Quraysh and in every household of Mecca. And she told her brother Abbas radiallahu anhu about this dream. Abbas radiallahu anhu told her, don't tell anybody about this. Because the Quraysh, at that time when she saw this dream originally, they had not left for Badr yet. And they would think that they are trying to derail the Quraysh. So he only told one of his friends, but as you know, once something leaves the mouth, it's common knowledge. You know, it doesn't come back. Everybody's like, I'm going to tell you something, don't tell anybody. And they're like, okay. And they tell somebody, I want to tell you something, don't tell anybody. And they go on and on. So news is got to Abu Jahl. And Abu Jahl, being a very low class, you know, very, what you would say, low chap, you know, somebody who was very ill-mannered person, he called Abbas al-Din. Abbas al-Din, who came, he was making tawaf, he told him that, you know, your tribe, and he's talking about your people, you guys used to have prophets amongst men, now you even have prophets amongst your women. Abbas al-Din, what are you talking about? He told him that before a man from your tribe, yani Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, claimed to be a prophet. Now a woman is seeing dreams. He's talking about his sister, ridiculing him. And he spoke very harshly and used very bad words. And Abbas radiallahu anhu decided that I'm going to kill Abu Jahl. Now this is background going on. But here, now, Abu Jahl, in the meantime, has already left for Badr. But in Mecca, even the women from that tribe who knew Atika radiallahu anha, they said that these men, they are not going to make it back. From that dream earlier, this is what's going on in Mecca. But back in Badr, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is spending the night in Salah, in Ibadah. And the Quraysh, what are they doing? They're partying. 3 days when they were in Badr, they're partying. They had brought with them singing girls and dancing girls and alcohol, and they're drinking and they're partying. And look at the kibar they had. That they weren't even worried. They said, this is going to be a slaughter. We have 1,000, they have 300. We have 100 horses, they have 2. We have so many camels, they have very few. We have armed weaponry. We have the most latest technology. They don't. It's going to be a slaughter. But remember, whenever any nation raises their head with kibar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lowers it. Many people don't learn this lesson. The British didn't learn their lesson. The Russians didn't learn their lesson. We hope from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that others learn their lesson before the heads are lowered. So here you see the Quraysh, they had kibar. We have weapons, we have money, we have everything. They were partying, they weren't even concerned. But Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is making dua. He's asking Allah, because he knows that the decision, the victory, is not because of weapons or numbers, but it is because of the nusra of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now the Quraysh, they sent people to go get water. Now the water is controlled by the Muslims, but it's only 300, and they're not well equipped. They only have a few swords. Otherwise some have spears and some have axes or whatever they could get. And the Quraysh look at them and say, they can't do anything. Look at them, they're weak. They're nothing. So they sent people, go get water from them. We're going to show them our pride. And when they came, the Sahaba, they shot arrows, and subhanAllah, all of them that were sent from Quraysh were killed. The first of the battle starts here, not like the movie. The first of the battle starts here, all of them are killed except for one, which is Hakim bin Hizam. Hakim bin Hizam, radiallahu anhu, he is not killed. And there's a hikmah, because later on he becomes a Muslim, and a very good Muslim. He is the only one that makes it back from the delegation of Quraysh that first went to try to put their power upon the Muslims. And this is where the first arrows are shot and the battle begins. It's reported in Sahih al-Bukhari that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam at this time, he was making dua. When he saw the Muslims beginning, he started to make dua. And some of the narrations mentioned that he stood up making dua, raising his hands. So much that he had a shawl, you know, the cloth, like a shawl, sadaq. He had it on his shoulders, this is from the sunnah. He had it and he got up to make dua and it fell. From him raising his hands and making dua, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now there is the idea that's put forward because of stupid movies and cartoons that the first thing that happened is 3 men of Quraysh came and then the 3 Sahaba. But this is actually not true. If you look at the books of Ibn Ishaq and Ibn Hisham, and if you look at Al-Bidayah al-Nihaya, if you look at any of the earlier books, or even Al-Rahiq al-Maktum of Al-Mubarak Puri and others, the first duel that happened was a mushrik from Quraysh named Al-Aswad ibn Abdul Asad al-Maghzum. Al-Aswad Ibn Abd al-Asad al-Makhzumi. He was a very rude man, a bad-tempered mushrik from Quraysh, and a very harsh man, somebody with a short temper. So when he saw this, when the arrows hit and then the Quraysh were killed, he got upset. He took his sword and he said, I'm going to go there and either I'm going to bring water or I'm going to destroy the well. What do these people think they are? And he's marched towards the Muslims. And who was the one that met him in battle first? Who was the one? Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib radiallahu anhu, the lion of Allah. He went forward alone and he had a duel with Aswad and he killed him. He hit him first on the leg, which dropped him, and then cut off his head. And he walked back to the Muslim camp. Now the armies are beginning. Here, after this duel, then the Quraysh sent forward Utbah ibn Rabi' and his brother Shayba ibn Rabi' and his son Al-Walid ibn Utbah. They're all related. Utbah ibn Rabi', Utbah's brother Shayba ibn Rabi' and Walid ibn Utbah. So the two men and one of them, Utbah's son, they go forward to first fight. And the way the Arab would fight is first they would send some, and there would be a fight, whichever number they would choose. And then if that didn't decide, then the whole armies would battle. So here, when these three step forward, who stepped forward for the Muslims? Ali?
No, somebody else.
Ali radiallahu anhu, no, three Ansari. And I told you the Ansar, they are brave people. Three of the Ansar, they step forward first. They said, this isn't about family feud, this isn't about, you know, tribes and money and wealth, this is about Islam. This battle of Badr is about Islam. And that's why three of the Ansar, they were the first one to step forward. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam let them go forward. But now the Quraysh, they backed out. They said, our fight is not with the Ansar. You know, sometimes people say, oh, fight equals of us. No. What they said is, our fight is not with the Ansar, not with the people of Medina. Now here, the Prophet ﷺ doesn't want them to have an excuse that, oh, they couldn't fight us, so they sent the people of Medina. So the Prophet ﷺ told the Ansar to step back. As obedience to the Amir, the Ansar, they stepped back. And Rasulullah ﷺ, he put forward Hamza ibn Abd al-Muttalib, Ubaidah ibn al-Harith, and Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. Ali ibn Abi Talib is a very young boy at this time. Different ulama have given different ages, but he's very young. Even so young that many of the historians have said that this was a mistake. The people who were Orientalists, the kuffar, they said this is a mistake. But we know that it wasn't. Because we know it's the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did what was best. Here, now Hamza, he begins the fight with Shayba. Shayba ibn Rabi', the brother of Utbah. And they fight, and Hamza radiallahu anhu easily defeats him. Easily kills him. Hamza was a warrior, radiallahu anhu, the lion of Allah. Then Ali radiallahu anhu, he fights Al-Walid, who is the son of Utbah. And Walid is younger, but he's still older than Ali radiallahu anhu, and is more experienced. And from physical ability stronger. But Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu is a great Sahabi, the brave Sahabi. He is the son-in-law of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is the cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One of the earliest to become Muslim, the first of the youth to be a Muslim. So he attacks with Iman, he kills Walid. And Walid is killed. Now the third of the duel is Ubaidah ibn al-Harith, and he is fighting Utbah. And Utbah, he gets an upper hand. He hurts him, he attacks him on the leg. And he chops with a vein with a lot of blood starts flowing. Hamza radiallahu anhu, he jumps in and he kills Utbah. Utbah bin Rabi' gets killed. And this tells you the rules of battle were not one-on-one, it was a battle. They squared off, but people were able to jump in. So here Hamza radiallahu anhu jumps in and he kills Utbah. Utbah, he dies as well. All three of the duels won by the Muslims. And this was a big setback for the Quraysh. Because these were professional warriors and brave men that they thought, you know, at least we'll try to square up. But they saw that the Muslims were fighting with Iman. They were fighting for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, Ubaidah, Ibn al-Harith radiallahu anhu, he becomes injured here. And after four, or according to some of the ulama of tariq, 5 days, he becomes shaheed because of that injury. And he is the first one to be injured from the Muslims in Badr. And then, even though there are some sahaba that become shaheed before him, because their death was instant and his took time, but he was the first one to be injured, and from that injury he becomes a shaheed for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, before the battle begins, and don't believe what the movie tells you, or cartoons, there are sahih ahadith that there were mala'ik, there were angels that rode. And inshallah, we'll cover that in the next class. Jazakumullahu khairan.
فَفِرُّوا